We are live on Facebook.
We're ready. We're live on Facebook. So, yeah, we got it.
Come on, dude. Come on. Come on. I'm going to close the door. Come on. Come on, y'all.
Just touch it up.
Are you guys waiting on me?
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry. Good morning. Welcome to this morning, Sunday morning with the Lord. Today is September 6th, 2020. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. And we want to welcome you via Zoom, via Facebook, to worship with the Second Missionary Baptist Church of Indio, California. Thank you, and we are glad that you came this way. Amen. At this time, we're going to have scripture and prayer by Deacon Robin Brown.
Our scripture is coming from John chapter 3, John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher, come from God, but no man can do these miracles that thou doest, except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of the water and of the spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Marvel not, I say unto thee, you must be born again. And God has a blessing to the reading and to the hearing of this holy word.
Amen.
Father, this is the day, Father, that you and your son Jesus have made. We ask, Father, that you would bless us and that we would be glad to be a part of this day, Father. Again, Father, we ask for a special blessing upon all these under the sound of my voice, Second Baptist as a whole, our pastor, where he sits, Father. We just ask, Father, that you would just bless us and keep us, O Heavenly Father. We thank you again, Father, for a wonderful and glorious day. We thank you, Father, for last night laying down. We thank you, Jesus, for this early morning rise. We just want to say thank you, for you are our God. We are your children. We ask for grace and mercy upon us this day, Father. Father, we just thank you for the little children, O Heavenly Father, for truly they are our future. We just ask, Father, that you will bless them and keep them, O Heavenly Father. Bless us, O Heavenly Father, that we are able to teach them and show them your word and your ways, so when they grow up, they won't depart from you, Father. Again, Father, we just want to say thank you. We ask, Father, that you would bless the auxiliary heads, oh Father. Bless them, Father, that they would lead in the pathway that you would have them to lead, that they would go where you would have them to go, Father. Again, Father, bless in a mighty way, Father. Bless the men of this church, oh Holy Father, the deacons. Bless the trustees as well, Father. Bless us all, oh Holy Father, as we're able to go out and witness in the name of your darling Son, Jesus Christ, oh Holy Father. Bless, Father, if we're able to go into the hospital, we're able to go into the prisons and seek after those who are lost and tell them about, see, Jesus Christ, our Lord, as well as our Savior, Father. Again, Father, you have blessed us and you have kept us and you have brought Second Baptist from a mighty long way, oh Holy Father. We ask of this prayer in Jesus' precious name we pray again. Amen and thank God.
Hallelujah. Amen. So at this time, we'll have a song of worship. Does Sister Daniel have that?
Listen, New York, because that's in faith church. It's about an every Sunday song. Listen, I don't need you to get tired now. I need those of you that are going to help us stand up and we're going to get God glory. We praise God. He has a name that's above every name. So the song just simply says this. He says, I call you holy. Your name is holy. You are so holy to me. Somebody say,
I call you holy. Your name is holy. Holy you are. And the holy.
Come on, I don't want you to raise your voice to the end of this room.
Thank you. But we say, great and mighty is our God.
Hallelujah, yes, you are. Now.
Somebody join and say, great and mighty. Say.
Great and mighty is our God.
If nobody like Jesus anymore.
Hallelujah.
Somebody say, great and mighty. Say.
Great and mighty is our God.
Nobody like the Lord. Nobody like the Lord.
Serve is a holy God. The God we serve is a mighty God. He is deserving of our praise, and we want to thank him. We want to praise him for all of his goodness to us. He didn't have to wake us up this morning, but he did, and we are grateful. We are thankful to the God of our salvation. If it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, tell me, where would we be? And in a day and time that we are in, it is great to know that we have someone on our side who is mighty, who is holy, who can see us through any trial and tribulation that we come to, and he brings us through. Amen. Amen. We're going to ask that you would make yourself ready for offering. As we prepare for offering, it is a blessing to give unto the Lord. Amen. For God has blessed us far above measure. Amen. When we look around and see all the things that God has blessed us with, we stand amazed for what he has done for us. Amen. Amen. If you would like to give through Giveify, you can give through Giveify, and you can give to Second Baptist Church, mail your offering to the Second Baptist Church, and the address should be on the screen. And if not, you can call the church at 760-347-3853 and give your offering to, or call for someone to come pick up your offering. Amen. 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 We're going to make ourselves ready for the word of God. We're going to be very brief this morning. And we pray that you all would join in with us. Stay with me. Amen. And we'll be gone. Amen. Shall we bow our heads in prayer? O most holy God, who knows each of us by name, we come to you requesting your presence to be with us as we stand to proclaim your most holy word. For without your presence, our worship and our very existence are in vain. I now humble myself in your presence, Lord, that your word goes forth with clarity, goes forth with boldness. Keep me in the center of your will, Lord. May I decrease that you would increase. May the proclamation of your word help someone on today. This is your servant's prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Just going to get right into it. Matthew chapter 20, verse 29 through 34. Amen. I'll give you a couple more seconds to get that. It's Matthew chapter 20, verse 29 through 34. And it reads, "And as they departed from Jericho, a great multitude followed him. And behold, two blind men sitting by the wayside, when they heard that Jesus passed by, cried out, saying, Have mercy on us, O Lord, thou son of David. And the multitude rebuked them because they should hold their peace. But they cried out the more, saying, Have mercy on us, O Lord, thou son of David. And Jesus stood still and called them and said, What will ye that I shall do unto you today? They say unto him, Lord, that our eyes may be open. So Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes, and immediately their eyes received sight. Immediately their eyes received sight, and they followed him. Immediately they received sight, and they followed him. I want to use or pin this passage. Jesus saves the desperate. Jesus saves the desperate. I recently viewed a videotape that is used to train lifeguards on how to recognize when someone is drowning. We often think that a person who is drowning will splash about in the water and yell and cry for help, help, I'm drowning. In reality, they become almost paralyzed by fear and incapable of calling for help. The video illustrated how this works. It showed a young girl of about 10 years of age sitting on an inner tube float in the middle of the deep end wave pool, surrounded by children and a few adults. I gotta turn my phone off because it's answering me. When the girl tried adjusting herself on the inner tube, she fell off and slipped to the bottom of the pool where the water was right over the top of her head. There was no splashing about, and she couldn't yell for help. Instead, subtly, her hands came up just above the surface as if she were reaching for something. Thankfully, a lifeguard spotted her and within a few seconds had a life raft under her to save her. The most remarkable thing was that the people around her were oblivious to the fact that she was drowning, that she had actually went under. My question to you, are you or are we the church oblivious to the fact that there are people all around us who are drowning in their sin? Are we oblivious to the fact that there are people all around us who are on their way to hell if we don't share the marvelous news of the gospel of Jesus Christ to them? They may not be splashing or yelling out for your help, but these desperate people are quietly calling out. And as Christians, we must learn to recognize the signs of someone struggling, paralyzed, blind, and overwhelmed by the power of sin. Don't be oblivious to the drowning soul right next to you. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9:22, to the weak, I became weak, to win the weak. I have become all things to all people so that by that all, so that by all possible means, I might save some. Here in our text today, there is an account that summons our attention. Watch here as the master turns tragedy into triumph, as he turns darkness into deliverance, and as he turns plight into praise. My friends, can you remember what the Lord saved you from? Can you remember what you were doing when the Lord saved you? Let me remind you today of what you used to do, of what you used to be. For some of us just might have selective memory. Paul says it like this in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11, in the King James Version. Know ye that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor the effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And he goes on to say in verse 11, and such were some of you, but you are washed by, and ye are sanctified, and ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of God. Listen. Listen, Second Baptist, and those listening via Facebook. Hallelujahs are in order for what he has done for us. Saints, I stand here to tell you that he has done some marvelous things for us. He has given us some marvelous promise. He saved us just in the nick of time. And I want to thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for me, for you didn't have to do it, but you did. And I thank you. I thank God today that he saved me. And I realized that I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very, very deeply stained with sin, I was sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters he lifted me. Now safe am I. Hallelujah. We are safe and we are saved. Thank you, Lord. You see, my friends, we were in desperate need of saving. And the only one that could save us did. All of mankind that ever was, is, will be, is born into this same state of desperation. Romans 5, verses 12 to 14 says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned, not y'all, but all have sinned. For unto the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression. Who is the figure of him that is to come? You see, my brothers and sisters, there is no escaping this desperate, depraved condition that we inherited from our foreparents. David said, I was born in sin, shapen in iniquity. We are all sinners in need of a savior. And thank God, he has provided a way for us to escape the damnation and the punishment of everlasting torment apart from God. There are three observations that is worth looking about these two desperate blind men. First, We want to see their location. Second, their lament and language. And third, their liberty. Their location, number one. Number two, their lament and language. And number three, their liberty. So let's take a trip down the dusty road of Jericho, where we will meet our Lord and his disciples and the accompanying crowd on their way to the Passover. They had crossed the Jordan and was in with a day's journey of Jerusalem. And down by the wayside, we come to these people and their location of these two blind men. These two blind men, one of whom is identified as blind Bartimaeus in Mark, the 10th chapter, and Luke, the 18th chapter, were sitting by the wayside. The wayside is a place of non-consideration. It is a place where you're in a condition of neglect and disuse. By the wayside, people look over you. By the wayside, people pass over you. By the wayside, people don't consider you or your needs. These two blind men, were by the wayside. They were by the wayside and they could not see. And because they were blind and they could not see and they could not work. Because they were by the wayside, they were blind, they could not see, they could not work. Because these two blind men could not see it, it resulted in them not being able to work. And so they were on the wayside begging. Scripture does not say how or when they become blind, but that Jesus restored their sight. In those days, if you were blind, you were considered cursed by God. If you were blind, could not see, you could not work, you couldn't fend for yourself, you were considered cursed by God. These two men, because of the fact that they were blind and could not see and could not work and were beggars and were on the wayside, they were considered to be cursed by God. They were in physical darkness. And because of their blindness, they were thrusted into poverty. Because of their blindness, their circumstances shoved them into being without. Because of their blindness, their plight positioned them into the platform of perilous perplexity. Because of their blind, because of their preconceived condition. What about us? Our condition. Where were we? We were lost without Christ, without Jesus. We were in the same position as these blind men. There was no Braille Institute of the Desert. There was no American Foundation for the Blind. They did not go to or have a GoFundMe page. There was no social programs for them. They were poor. These blind men were social outcasts. They were beggars. They were street trash. They were residents of Skid Row. And just imagine, if you will, what they must have looked like, being that they could not take care or fend for themselves. They were at the mercy of the people around them. And you know. You can't depend on people. You can't depend on people when the chips are down all the time, as they were blind. They had to totally depend on somebody to take care of them. Look at them. Here they are. The lowest of the low. Here they are, the bottom of the totem pole. Here they are, the rejects of society. Yes, They were desperate. Yes, they are desperate, disconnected, disparaged, and displaced. These blind men were physically, socially, and spiritually in a desperate location. But something happened. Jesus shows up. And thank God, in your life, in my life, Jesus shows up. And had it not been for God, who was on your side, where would we be? Where would we be? My brothers and sisters, sometimes our location sets us up for the delivery and power of Jesus Christ. Sometimes our desperate location helps us to seize the opportunity and also helps us to see the face of Jesus. Look at these men. Look at them. Look at them. Let's look at these men. As Jesus passes by, my friends, we're just like these men. In a way, we may not be blind physically. The passage speaks of all of us. We are all these blind men. We are all in a desperate situation. And until Jesus shows up, nothing changes. This passage shows us that Jesus has a divine appointment to come your way. Yeah, he has a divine appointment to come your way. And thank God he came my way. Thank God he came your way. Thank you, Lord, that he kept his divine appointment. Yes. And the fact that you are sitting where you are sitting gives support to their position. Because they were physically blind, their mobility was limited so that they could not be about that life. They were physically blind and their mobility was limited and they couldn't go get what they wanted. They couldn't do what they wanted to do. They were in prison, so to speak, because their condition restricted them from doing anything. Saints of Second Baptist and those viewing, until Jesus changed your spiritual condition, and we were like they were. Yes, we were. You might not want to admit it, but we were like they were. Yes, we were on our way to a place apart from God had not Jesus come by our way. We were lifeless. We were spiritually unproductive. We were not yielding any spiritual fruit. We were spiritually barren, unresponsive, and desperate. So in our spiritual blindness, we just sat idle. Some of us are still sitting idle, but we just sat idle. But thank God, Jesus came your way. Thank God, Jesus came your way. And as Jesus comes near these blind men, they immediately cry out, "Have mercy on us, thou son of David." Second Baptist and viewers, mercy needs misery to give it a reason to work. These two blind men sitting by the wayside could not see Jesus. But we are asked to look at them. We're asked to behold them. These two blind men had taken up a hopeful position by the wayside. For there, they would likely hear any good news, and there they could be seen by the compassionate. Upon inquiry, they learned that Jesus was passing by, and believing that he could restore their sight, grew in earnest prayer and petition to him. So much so that they cried out. And now they cried out. Let's look at their lament and their language. They cried out. Their plea was for pity. Have mercy on us. Their appeal was to the royal heart, the divine heart of Jesus. They cried, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on us. Neither here, these two men were blind and deaf. All throughout scripture, we see where men were handicapped in one area, but they could hear. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 3 says, hear and your soul shall live. When God struck Zacharias in Luke chapter chapter 1, verse 22, he made him dumb, but not deaf. When God struck Saul on the road to Damascus, he made him blind, but not deaf. When God struck Mephibosheth, he made him lame, but not deaf. These two blind men had heard of Jesus Christ by the hearing of the ear. But that did not satisfy them. They needed to see him. A lot of us, we hear of Jesus. We've heard of his wondrous works. We've heard that he can save us from the guttermost to the uttermost. But do you really want to see him? Do you really want to see him? If you want to see him, then that changes your whole perspective. I want to see him. Look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Home at last. Yes, they wanted to see him. What about you, my dear hearts? Are you satisfied with just hearing about Jesus? Or are you in need of seeing the Savior? Are you concerned about seeing the Savior? It is no doubt that these blind men had heard about Jesus, about what Jesus had done for other blind men. It is no doubt that these blind men had heard of all the miracles that Jesus had performed. And as a crowd near, this was their once in a lifetime opportunity. It is now or never. Our freedom is from darkness is now or never. Our deliverance is now or never. Don't wait. Don't wait too late to get your household straight, for Jesus is coming back real soon. So in their lament, they had a cry that could not be silenced. I like that. You hear me up. Oh no. I heard too much about you. Can't shut me up. That's a message all in itself right there, but you can't shut me up. So in their lament, they had a cry that could not be silenced. They applied to Jesus for help. They said, O Lord, thou son of David, have mercy on us. These two blind men might have been plagued with vision loss physically, but they had heard enough to know who Jesus was. And in my 50 years of living, sometimes the ones who you wouldn't think to know about Jesus has a better grasp and grip on who he is than the ones who say they walk with him daily. Help us, Lord. Look at all the theology that was wrapped up in their statement. They said, O Lord, thou son of David, have mercy on us. By calling him Lord, these two blind men observe titles of honor, by which declared their faith in him. By calling him Lord, they were expressing their sense of his deity. By calling him Lord, they were acknowledging his dominion. By calling him Lord, they were admitting to his power. By calling him Lord. Is he Lord of your life? by calling him the son of David, they were drowning, they were owning and professing him to be the Messiah. Look at their petition. Their petition is that he would first have mercy on them. These two men, blind men, suffered from blindness, poverty, helplessness, hopelessness. They were in a miserable condition. And this desperation made them cry out in a loud voice that Jesus might hear them and take pity on them. They were eagerly desirous of having their sight and firmly believed that Jesus was able to restore it to them. God is able to do just what he said he would do. He's going to fulfill the promises to you. So what you got to do, don't give up on God, for he won't give up on you, because why? He's able. And these blind men knew that he was able to restore their sight to him, to them. Second Baptist had people listening. When blinded eyes are opened and healed by Jesus, there is no mistaking who he is and the perfect power and absolute authority that resides in him. I wonder what their song might have been. Maybe it was, or it is, I know a man from Galilee who saved my soul. Or maybe it's, there's been a change in me. Once blind, but now I see. God gave me victory and he did it suddenly. He changed the way I walk. He changed the way I talk. He changed my attitude and he did it suddenly. He did it suddenly. He did it suddenly. Help me, Holy Spirit. He did it suddenly at the cross. At the cross. Maybe that was their song. Where I first saw the light. And the burdens of my heart were rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight. And now I'm happy all the day. These blind men had faith in what they had heard and wanted a desperate change. Even though the multitude rebuked them and tried to get them to shut up, they cried even louder. Have mercy on us, O Lord, thou son of David. We know who you are. Have mercy on us, thou son of David. The rebuke, however, had no effect on these blind men, except to increase their fervency of their cry. These blind men knew that at that moment they had a unique opportunity and they would not and could not be silenced. Second Baptist and people listening, whenever a soul cries out after Jesus for light and salvation, the world and the devil join together to drown out its cries or tries to force it to be them to be silent. The devil and his imps try to hinder those regarded as merely troublesome from coming to Jesus. These blind men's cry is that of desperation. Inspiration and faith, a combination that Jesus never fails to hear. My dear hearts, there is sufficient mercy in Christ Jesus for all who ask. The words to that great hymn are screaming at us today. You remember, pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not, O Lord, do not pass me by. Notice here what the master does when they cry out. Notice what he does. It says it here in verse 32. And Jesus stood still and called them. Jesus stood still when they cried. He stood still. Look at the power of fervent prayers can do for you. Christ stands still, and stays. Christ stops, stands still, and he stays. And whenever the petition is accompanied by faith, Jesus will respond. Come here, woman with the issue of blood. You remember the woman that had the issue of blood? For 12 long years, she had pressed her way to get to where Jesus was as he touched the hem of his garment. And at the end of the conversation that she had with him, Jesus tells her to go her way. Why? Because your faith has made you whole. Come here, blind man with leprosy. Or come here, man with leprosy. Tell us your story. Well, Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem, and my friends and I met Jesus as he entered the village, and we shouted out unto him, "Master, have mercy on us." And he told us to go show ourselves to the priest. And as we were going, we were all changed. And when I returned to give him thanks, he told me, "Rise and go. My faith had made me whole." Hebrews 4:16, the record states, "Let us draw near to God with confidence, to the throne of grace, so that we receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of needs." My friends, I have stopped by to let you know that Jesus responds to the merciless that reach out to him in faith. Jesus says it over in Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 through 8. "Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth, and he that findeth, unto him that knocketh, it shall be opened." Thank God that he hears our cry. And because he heard them, he stops, he stands still, and he stays. Something happens. Liberty is given unto those three blind men. Notice here what Jesus does for these blind men. He calls them over and asks them the question, "What do you want me to do for you?" These men went straight to the point. They didn't waste no time. They didn't give no. "Well, I would have done it." They didn't give no feeble explanation. They went straight to the point. They wasted no time. They did not need time for second thoughts. Their one thing that they desired was to have their sight. What these blind men wanted was to physically come out of darkness. They wanted it. Yeah, they wanted it. That's another message right there. They wanted it. They wanted the shackles of hopelessness to be broken. They wanted their liberty. They wanted their freedom from a bound life. And my brothers and my sisters, Jesus comes to give you freedom from a bound life, a life that has you bound. Jesus comes to give it to you. But as these blind men, you have to, what? Want it. You gotta want it. The text here informs us that Jesus had compassion on them. The Savior was moved with tender pity. Here we see the compassion of Christ meet the desperate cry of the blind men. And immediately their cure was the result. Jesus here touches their eyes of these blind men, and immediately their eyes receive sight. These blind men, now liberated from their physical, became disciples of Jesus Christ. These men became disciples. They embraced his doctrines. They believed in him as Messiah. They submitted to his ordinances. They imitated him in the exercise of grace, and they followed him in obedience to their duty because Jesus touched them. Yes, he touched them. At the same time, he restored the physical sight. He also gave them a spiritual one to look at him, to follow him with. Not only does Jesus tend to what we need, to tend to what we want, but he also gives us what we need. And what we need is spiritual wholeness. Thank you, Lord. Notice what they did. In Luke's gospel, the record states that they followed him and glorified God. Oh, right there. That's another message. They followed him and they glorified God. Let that sink in. They followed him and they glorified God. They lived a life that was worth glorifying God. People knew who they were. They were the men set free from physical blindness. And because Christ had done what he did for them, they followed him and glorified him. Hallelujah. What about you? What has Christ done for you? What has he set you free from? And in result to that, what are you doing? What are you doing? In this time of COVID-19, you got all this time on your hands. What are you doing? You're retired. What are you doing? What are you doing with the time right now to glorify God? They followed him and glorified him. And all the people, when they saw what he had done for these blind men, they also gave praise to God. Your life is a living testimony. I am a living testimony. I couldn't have made it on my own. I'm not standing here alone. It was Jesus who saved me and gave me the victory. I am a living testimony. He healed me. I am a living testimony. He saved me. I am a living testimony. He put hope and joy down in my soul. I am a living testimony. And my heart, my dear heart, I don't know about you, but I'm glad that Jesus saved me and my salvation was made possible because of Jesus and the finished redemptive work on the cross of Calvary. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where he took me in. Glory to his name. Oh, precious fountain that saves from sin. I am so glad I have entered in. There, Jesus saves me and he keeps me clean. Glory to his name. At the cross where believers meet up with a loving God. At the cross where blind men find their sight. At the cross where lost men find their way. At the cross where men and women in darkness find the light of life and find joy for their sorrow. At the cross. We need to get excited about the cross. At the cross, where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart all rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. At the cross, where a dirty world met up with and was cleansed by a holy God. At the cross, where the gloom of man met the glory of the Master. At the cross, where sinners that were stained and saturated with sin met the blood of Jesus that washes them whiter than snow. At the cross where weary men find rest for their souls. At the cross where sin-sick folk meet a divine healer. At the cross, down folk meet the love of a lifting Savior. Down at the cross where dark folk meet the light of the world. at the cross where depressed men and women meet a joyful Savior. At the cross where weak men find strength for their journey. At the cross. It is at the cross. It is at the cross. Down at the cross where my Savior died. Down where from cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood of my glory to his name. And just like these blind men, Lord, I'll praise you. I'll praise you because you have done so much for me. I cannot tell it all. When I look back over my life and see where you brought me from, you brought me from a mighty long way. And you're still bringing me, and you will bring me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your word. During his time on earth, Jesus was always inviting people to become his followers. He said to those by the Sea of Galilee, follow me. Jesus invited his listeners to come to him by faith, to come for healing, to come for hope, to come for happiness. Matthew 11:28 says, come to me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Matthew 16:24 says, if anyone desires to come after me, let him take up his cross and follow me. And perhaps on today, you feel the Spirit of God speaking to you, that he's calling you. And I'm asking you, my brother and my sister, to listen and answer the call. Come to him willingly. Come to him courageously. Come to him by faith. Come to him now. This is your time with Christ. He's calling you as an individual, calling you as a couple, calling you as a family. And I stand here today to let you know that Jesus suffered, he bled, and he died just for you and for me. He had you and I on his mind. And the redemptive blood of Jesus washes away our sins. And he can give you new life if you'll only come to him. If you need help in coming to him, you can call the church, 760-347-3853, and someone will help you with your decision. Amen. This is our message. We would ask you to be in prayer for our pastor and family as they're traveling. Be in prayer for all the saints. Be in prayer for the whole wide world, because we need the power of God to intervene in our affairs. And here is the benediction. Dismiss us now, O Lord, in your name. Send us forth and in your power. Keep us in your care. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. May God bless you and keep you. And go with God.